रहीम, टुडे वी विल डिस्कस अबाउट द लैब डायग्नोसिस ऑफ डायबिटीज मेलिटस, व्हिच इज वेरी इंपॉर्टेंट इन दिस कॉन्टेक्स्ट दैट इफ द पेशेंट इज राइटली डायग्नोस्ड इन टाइम ही मे अवॉइड डेवलपमेंट ऑफ द कॉम्प्लिकेशंस एट द लेटर स्टेज. एज अर्ली एज इट इज डायग्नोस्ड द कॉम्प्लिकेशंस मे बी डिलेड. We'll discuss about the lab diagnosis and what is impaired glucose tolerance. Patient may not be labeled as clearly diabetic, patient may not be labeled as non-diabetic. Then diagnostic criteria of diabetes mellitus, which is very important, and on this basis we have to diagnose the patients. These are developed by WHO, International Federation of Diabetes Mellitus, or American Diabetic Association. Then what comprehensive evaluation of diabetes must be done for assessment of the complications. Clinically, patient may present with symptoms which may be vague, which may be definitely specific for the diabetes, like 3Ps, which is common, polyuria, polydipsia, or polyphagia. Patient may present with the history of only weight loss, or he may complain of some fatigue and no other complaint. And if his blood sugar is advised, it may be ending up with a known case of diabetic. Then a patient having no diabetic history is having recurrent infection. In that case, blood glucose is routinely advised to assess the level of hyperglycemia. Now, who are at risk? Pregnant females, elderly people, and obese persons. These must be screened, or their lab tests should be done to assess the development of, or the presence of, the diabetes. Moreover, diabetogenic drugs like glucocorticoids, which are being used by different patients in different conditions, they must also be assessed for the level of the hyperglycemia or blood glucose level. Screening for the diabetes is advocated for over 45 years of age of the persons. They must get their diabetes assessment in the form of the blood glucose or in the form of the HbA1c at regular intervals to avoid further complications if they are not developed, if they are not diagnosed at right time. What blood test we can use? It may be just simple capillary blood, or it may be whole blood, or we may also use just serum for that one. Preferably, the venous blood is used for the accurate diagnosis of blood glucose levels. Whole blood levels 10 to 15% lower than the plasma. So venous blood is 10 to 10% lower than the capillary blood. Capillary blood is that in which we use glucometers for assessing the blood glucose level. There is no role of insulin or fructosamine in the diagnosis of diabetes mellitus. I'm saying in the diagnosis, but in level of the insulins may be necessary at some stage of the diabetes mellitus. What influences can be there on a blood glucose report when you are seeing the report of a patient of blood glucose? It may be, depend on the sample type, how it is taken, how much time it has elapsed, then which analytical method has been used, either it is specific one or not. Then interpretation problems may be there. What are the different levels? Exact levels of fasting after breakfast and random, they must be in mind when you are doing the house job to assess a report of diabetes mellitus. Then changing diagnostic criteria, which is more or less after 2 or 3 years, change is being changed due to the different research which is being done on the diabetes. Now there are three terms. One is the normality, second is the impaired glucose tolerance, and third is the diabetes mellitus. Clear? In normality, the fasting blood glucose should be 70 to 110, rather it is 100 now. It is not 110. 2 hours after breakfast, blood sugar level should be less than 140. These figures you have to remember. Now, mind it that fasting level should be between 70 to 100 if you have to label the patient as non-diabetic. And 2 hours after breakfast, it should be less than 140. Now, this impaired glucose means if it is between 100 and 126, then it is impaired. He is not labeled as diabetic. He is labeled as pre-diabetic, or he is having impaired glucose tolerance. The level between 2 hours after breakfast, between 140 and 200, is also pre-diabetic or impaired. This must further be documented by repeat testing after some time. If a patient gives the blood for the fasting and his level is more than 126, he is diabetic. And if his level 2 hours after breakfast is more than 200, then he is clearly diabetic. There is no need of further testing. There is some criteria which we will discuss, in which it says that it may be on two occasions. Diagnostic criteria of diabetes, which is developed by different organizations, and mostly they are followed by different countries, International Federation of Diabetes and WHO and American Diabetic Associations. They lay down their guidelines how to diagnose the diabetes. As I said, if the level is fasting plasma glucose level more than 126, it is diabetic. Fasting should be at least of 8 hours with no caloric intake, or 2 hours post glucose more than 200 during an OGTT. OGTT means oral glucose tolerance test, in which we give 75 gram of glucose to the patient and then we check the level after 2 hours. If it is more than 200, it is clearly diabetic. It means that we have given the load of 75 gram glucose to the patient, which is the maximum load, and there should be a proper response of the insulin. There should be proper biophysic response of insulin by the pancreas in response to the 75 gram glucose. If the levels are more than 200, then it means there may be some problem in the action, or there may be some problem in the insulin secretion. And next is HbA1c. It means if it is more than 6.5 in a patient, then he is diabetic. HbA1c shows the level of blood glucose level during the last 3 months. That is the average of the blood glucose in the past 3 months. But it must be done from a standardized lab who are using these assays. You don't have to go into the detail of these assays, but HbA1c level is now included in the diagnostic criteria. If a patient comes with the classic symptoms of the hyperglycemia, which we discussed, like polyuria, polydipsia, numbness, or any other complaint, fatigue, these type of the symptoms are present and the random blood glucose level is more than 200, then he is diabetic. It means there is definitely increased blood glucose level along with the symptoms. These are not with the symptoms. This should be kept in mind. Now, this diagnostic criteria may be asked in a scenario, or it may be asked in the Viva, which is very important. And you have to keep in mind the levels of the fasting and after breakfast in your mind, which are very commonly asked. Now, what should be the approach? Random plasma glucose level, if it is less than 100, then no diabetes. If it is 200, more than 200, clearly diabetes, which we discussed in the previous slide. And if the fasting plasma glucose level is more than 126, he is diabetic. This one is the impaired fasting glucose. These two levels, 100 to 126. This is not 110, this is 100 to 126. Then if we have to diagnose impaired fasting glucose condition, then we have to proceed to the oral glucose tolerance test. As I said in the earlier slide, that if after the oral 75 gram of glucose, the level at 2 hours is more than 200, then he is diabetic. This should be kept, this is performed only for the impaired. If the level is already random is more than, then there is no need of this one. If these levels are in this range, 100 to 126, or 140 to 200, then we have to proceed to the oral glucose to confirm the diagnosis of diabetes. It is not recommended for the routine diagnosis. Keep it in mind, it's not routinely performed. It should only be performed in the doubtful cases or the impaired tolerance cases. Establishing the diagnosis of the gestational diabetes mellitus, and for the impaired fasting or the impaired glucose tolerance, which we discussed. These are the two indications of the oral glucose tolerance test. Now, just have a look on this curve of the oral glucose tolerance. We have given 75 gram at this zero level. There are three curves. One is normal, this is this one. Glucose level goes from this and then comes down. This is in millimoles, you don't have to worry about. It should be keeping in mind when we convert these values, they come up to the about, if it is 10, it should be less than 100. This is the renal threshold, that is 180 milligram. If we multiply any value of the blood glucose with the 18 in millimole, that comes up to the blood glucose in milligram. Then we measure. This is the old method of documenting the glucose level. But in oral glucose tolerance test, these three curves are important. You may be given one of these curves and you will be asked about what type of the problem is. If this curve is there, that level is already increased at the fasting zero level, then after giving the glucose this level, but it does not come down. In a normal patient, level comes down like this. It should not go more than 200 at any stage. This is the elementary lag storage curve where there is a deposition after carbohydrate diet due to some surgical procedure on the stomach. There may be lag storage and there may be glycosuria along with the one rise above the average level of the glucose, which is more than 200. Now, what comprehensive diabetic evaluation we can do in a patient? Blood glucose fasting is important. A1C, HbA1c, if results are not available for the last 2 to 3 months, then fasting lipid profile, including the total cholesterol, LDL, HDL cholesterol, and triglyceride. These are done because patient may be having some problem in his lipid metabolism, which is very common in diabetic patients. Then spot urine albumin creatinine ratio. This is done just to assess the complication of the nephropathy. This ratio is important, or simply we can go for the microalbuminuria. Microalbuminuria is that in which there is very less amount of the secretion of the albumin. Normally it is excreted in the protein, is excreted in the urine normally. But it is that one which is not detectable by the routine method, but there is level of increased protein in the urine. One more figure you have to remember for that one is 24-hour urinary protein level is less than 150 milligram per day. This must be kept, I repeat it again, that 24-hour urinary protein levels are less than 150 milligram per day. If it is 160, if it is 170, it may not be detectable. We may miss it. For that, we have to perform the microalbumin urea, which is more sensitive method. Then serum creatinine and calculated GFR to assess the function of the kidney, because nephropathy is the common complication of the long-standing diabetic patients. Then thyroid in diabetes, it is also an autoimmune disease, hyperthyroidism, hypothyroidism. They may coexist with the diabetes. A patient may be having some other autoimmune diseases. Then dyslipidemia or women more than 50 years of age. In these cases, TSH should be done. Now, just coming to this little scenario, a family physician suspects that a diabetic patient is not following his diet and carefully controlling his blood glucose level, although the blood glucose level is always normal when he visits the clinic. What should the physician do to determine if the suspicion is correct? It means that whenever the patient goes to the clinic, his blood glucose level is okay. Then how the doctor can assess? At that time level is normal, he may be diabetic. Which one of these parameters we can go for the assessment of the previous glucose level? As I told you, this may be the MCQ. In this case, it will be A1C. You have to request for the A1C levels, which will tell you, that average will tell you what is the actual average level of the past 2 to 3 months, which may not correlate with the present glucose level. If the present glucose level is normal and HbA1c level is increased, it means that level is normal due to some other conditions. He may be not be properly having the food, or he may be having some other problems. But normal glucose level and increased HbA1c levels, they are not to be considered that the patient is not diabetic. A patient was brought to the emergency room in a coma to differentiate between the diabetic coma and hypoglycemic coma. The most helpful test would be, you can assess which will be, because he may be in the hypoglycemic coma, then which one? Blood pH. He may be having diabetic ketoacidosis. He may be having hyperosmolar non-ketotic coma. Which test will be more appropriate? Obviously, the blood glucose level. That will be random or whatsoever. At that time, if it is less, you have to treat the patient accordingly. If it is increased, you can differentiate between the diabetic coma or the hypoglycemic coma. So in next lecture, we'll discuss about other things like its complications, and also some scenarios and the MCQs in the next lecture. Thank you very much.